Maryland Heights Overlook Trail, and the Salty Dog Tavern, and the Potomac Pedicure, and dance hiking, and the pawpaw. This is part of the cornucopia tour with plenty of information packed as tightly as I could get it. The following is just over 1 minute of logistics you may want to know. From the lower town, you can see the Maryland Heights Overlook. It's only 331 feet above the roadway. You can also see what remains of a billboard from the 1900s painted onto a flat area of the overlook. It reads, Menon's Borated Talcum Toilet Powder. By the way, you can purchase this exact product from the NPS bookstore in the lower town. A round trip, with some time resting at the overlook, is usually 3 hours or more. The summit is 694 feet above the trailhead and 363 feet above the overlook. The combined ascent or gain is over 1,000 feet. There have been times in my life that I could not make it the entire way to the overlook. Abe Lincoln couldn't make it on his first try. Here is the path and distances of the Maryland Heights Trail. It is 1.48 miles long. The features of the Maryland Heights Trail are the trailhead, the Naval Battery, the summit, and the overlook. Most trailgoers make this 0.9-mile trek just to get to the trailhead. Many park or begin at the train station parking lot. We'll start the tour from the entrance of the train station. There used to be a canal between the train station and Potomac Street. It no longer exists. The canal water flowed into 7 tunnels, mostly to turn water wheels. These water wheels provided physical power for the production of goods in the armory buildings that used to be there. Then the water flowed out through the back of the same 7 tunnels and into the Potomac River. The outflow portions of the tunnels are called Tailraces. Remnants of these legacy tunnels still exist, and one is under this entrance area. Now back to the path to the trail. As you begin your hike from the entrance of the train station, you will see a cave under a restaurant eating deck. It has a cave drawing of an Ice Age goat or rabbit in a hole. You will also pass by these buildings: Almost Heaven Pub and Grill, Creamy Creations Ice Cream, Coach House Bar and Grill, Harpers Ferry Outfitters and Bike Shop, A La Mode Cafe, Coffee Mill, Meriwether Lewis at Harpers Ferry Museum, and Whitehall Tavern Museum. On this day, there was a very low cloud ceiling. While you are on the portion of your hike between the Whitehall Tavern Museum and the bottom of the Footbridge staircase, you will be on the Appalachian Trail. John Brown's Fort, actors tell stories of John Brown's raid. During the Civil War, Union soldiers broke pieces of brick and wood off the fort to keep as souvenirs. This is actually the 5th location John Brown's Fort has stood. It has moved 5 times and has been in Chicago, Illinois, and the Storer College campus in Harpers Ferry. The reason this building is such a monumentally significant part of the United States is because John Brown was captured in it and later hung. And, as Frederick Douglass said, John Brown began the war that ended American slavery and made this a free republic. Here is John Brown's fort. Cross under the railroad overpass to get to the footbridge. These stairs and tunnel are across from John Brown's fort. During record floods, the water exits through this tunnel. Information on past floods is posted across from the bookstore. In 1996, there were two record floods. Additional 1996 flood marks are inside of the bookstore. We have now walked under the railroad overpass. This spot is known as the Point. Below it is the confluence of the Potomac River and the Shenandoah Rivers. Also below it is a municipal boat ramp. Swift water rescue boats are often seen here. Many photos for engagements and formal events feature this and other nearby backgrounds. You can see three states from this point. There used to be a suspension truss bridge here. It was destroyed to varying degrees by man four times and then completely by a 1936 flood. A fur trader named Peter Stevens and a Native American guide named, quote, Gutterman Tom, started operating the ferry at about this location in 1733. There is also historical information that suggests the original ferry could have been located on the Shenandoah River just above the confluence, or 2,800 feet down the Potomac River at the end of the White Horse Rapids. Back to the ferry operators. Peter Stevens was the first European to settle in what is now Harpers Ferry. He was German. Many German settlers came to this area. Gutterman Tom was likely Shawnee Native American. One could speculate that a possible given name for him could have been Tenskwatawa. Shawnee people inhabited the area at the time. This arrowhead was recently found 16 miles downstream in this same Potomac River. Robert Harper bought the ferry, but Stevens, and who we'll refer to as Tenskwatawa, founded it. Now back to the path to the trail. On this footbridge, you can walk over the Potomac River from West Virginia to Maryland. Sometimes visitors are searched here. From the footbridge, you can see what was to be Robert Harper's house. Construction began on it in 1775. This was the USGS river level transmitter that was replaced by a wired system. In late 2019, a train derailment took out part of the footbridge. It was several months before it was fixed. This is an osprey's nest on the supports of the bridge. They nest there almost every spring now. There is a second osprey nest, an incomplete one, closer to the Overlook side of the bridge. I must have walked under it 50 times or more and still did not notice it until recently. From the footbridge, I often see fish in the river below. In this group, it appears like one of the fish is an albino. An angler that caught a 5-pound catfish from the footbridge told me that recently he saw a 20-pound catfish in the water below. He was not able to catch it. Other anglers have told me they've caught catfish here with artificial lures. If you wade in this section of the Potomac, minnows will nibble at your ankles. The benefit is that they will exfoliate you. The drawback is that they could spread pathogens to you. These locks rarely last more than 2 months here. I do like to read them. The spiral staircase at the end of the footbridge is very sturdy. However, many dogs don't like it, and they need to be carried up and down it. There are three trail counters you will see on the way to the Maryland Heights Overlook. Trail counters are very valuable because they help determine how much money can be spent on updating the trails. You are now on the towpath. A lot of bicyclists park at the Brunswick train station or the Point of Rocks train station. That way they do not have to deal with parking in Harpers Ferry. The spot here between these two elevated railroad tracks is very popular for taking photos and videos. This whitewashing on the overlook face is the result of peregrine falcons. It's difficult to make out, but this is a peregrine falcon on the Overlook base in late August 2019. Here you see some technical climbers on the cliff. These two cliff climbers told me they don't like to climb when the temperature is in the 90s Fahrenheit. They also said they've surprised people getting photos of themselves on the Overlook when they appeared on the upper edge of the cliff behind them.
I'm king of the world!
Cliff climbers must register first. You won't find these signs unless you go to the bottom of the cliffs. This bypass flume was used to divert water in Lock 33 when the canal was in operation. This is the inside of it now. These stone ruins are not Lockhouse 33. This building was formerly a residence and a store. On the left side of it was the Salty Dog Tavern. That building is no longer standing. According to local legend, during the Prohibition era, someone drank moonshine and backed their car into the canal right in front of the Salty Dog Tavern. The tavern no longer exists and likely burned or rotted, as most wooden structures that are abandoned do. The towpath, which was originally designed for mules to pull the boats in the canal, provides a lot of nice scenery today. There are not many biting insects here except in the fall. When insect-eating dragonflies and damselflies leave us in October, gnats become unwelcomely present on the trail. This heart-shaped formation is called a mating wheel and is often seen at the Potomac River. I often see crows and ravens here at this rocky outcrop at the same time. I'm not sure whether it's one of the species or both of the species, but I've seen them go into one of the caverns at night to roost. There was a landslide here, and since then, they've shored up the bottom of it. Just beyond that, I've seen turkey vultures roosting on a high outcrop. This is CNO Canal, mile marker 61. Not far after it is the entrance to the trail. We'll skip the footbridge for the trail for now. At just under 0.2 miles past the trail, there was a small parking area. There is a really nice set of small waterfalls here. Let's get back to the footbridge that leads to the trailhead. On the footbridge for the trail are some views of a small hydroelectric plant across the Potomac River. That plant used to get water from its adjacent Potomac Canal to generate electricity from 1899 to 1991. The hydroelectric plant and the Potomac Canal are no longer functioning. 100 yards to the right of the plant is Burn Island. In 1879, an amusement park called Island Park was built there. It was completely destroyed in a 1942 flood. This island was known for its Memorial Day cultural celebrations. Its band shell has stood in 3 locations and is now located in the upper town. Back again to the footbridge. This spot is 0.9 miles from the train station. We'll start our trail distance counter at 0 here. Here's the trailhead, the entrance to the trail. There is not much space at the trailhead. It angles down right into the road. If you were to drop a water bottle, it would roll into the road. About 120 feet past the trailhead is a flatter, wider area where there are several signs to read. One important thing to know is that there are no restrooms here. There is a paragraph about the red trail, but there's no mention of the green trail except on the painting from 1863. Here are some of my own brief notes on the trails to take. The green trail has green blazes, and the red trail has red blazes. About 50 feet to the right of the signs is an old driveway and ruins of possibly a home from maybe 1900 to the 1930s. About 75 to 100 feet behind the signs is a grotto. It can fit about 3 or 4 adults in it. There are what looks like 2 small cavities or caverns within view of the trail. There are actually 3 of them if you get closer. The one on the top left is small and you can't see much inside of it. The one on the right is wide and has another opening because you can see light showing inside of it. The bottom left one also has another opening. Additionally, it has what's either a white-footed deer mouse nest or a phoebe bird nest. Here is our second counter, the first one on the trail. This is the first turn. It's the only place on the trail besides the Overlook that you can get some pretty nice vistas of the river. From here, in January 2023, I heard eagle calls coming from what looks like an eagle nest on Burn Island. Sometimes on the hike, I see turkeys here. I don't have any footage of them yet. I did get a turkey video though, but it wasn't here. It was from my living room, and it was walking across my street. When you see the black culvert, you've gone 0.3 miles. That's halfway to the battery. On the way back from a sunset hike, it became dark and I heard a strange sound. I was not sure what it was. Ultimately, I figured out it was a screech owl, and I do have video of a screech owl that I got from a trail cam I had about 10 miles away. It was actually eating a worm. As you walk up the trail, you can look down and see a lot of nice views of the small creek on the left side of it in a ravine. This is ideal habitat for the eastern red-backed salamander. Their bodies have anti-disease properties. It is the most abundant animal with a backbone in forests like this one. Here is the third counter. It's also the second and final one on the trail. This is the Naval Battery area. One interesting thing to note is that the shells that were shot out of the cannons, they were shaped like bullets and they weighed 70 pounds. When they hit their target, they would explode. This is the 0.7 mile point, about halfway to the Overlook and 0.4 miles to the summit. Beep, 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 beep. I've been hiking on trails in the area for years, and I do it every month, but never did I get exposed to the pawpaw fruit until I hiked the Maryland Heights Trail in one late August. Pawpaw fruit are a little larger than a chicken egg. They're the area's only large indigenous fruit. I was first told about these and how to eat them from trailgoers from Singapore and Russia. Lewis and Clark actually survived on these on their cross-country journey when they could not find any other food. By the way, Meriwether Lewis spent some time in Harpers Ferry working on a boat design. Let's get back to the pawpaw fruit. Pawpaws are said to be named after the papaya. They taste like a cross between a mango and a banana. This is how you open them in the field. They have 6 seeds inside of them. Do not eat the peel.
Pawpaw trees are actually understory trees that do not get very large. This is what a pawpaw patch looks like.
The Naval Battery is between 2 pawpaw patches. There are some treacherous tree roots just beyond the battery. The photo doesn't quite depict how hazardous they are. At the end of this trail segment with tree roots, make a right turn at the T. The marker post for this spot has come out of the ground. This is the Stone Fort sign. In the warm season, I see a lot of wildlife between here and the summit, mostly lizards. This 5-lined skink was on the trail. It is a lizard and not a salamander. When young, their tails are almost a neon blue. There are many adorable pets here, some with some very interesting backpacks. This was not on the trail. I left the trail for a bit and found it. It's a harmless garter snake. I see them because I look for them.
This is a rocky, treacherous section just before the summit.
This is the eastern fence lizard. There are many of them about 5 to 10 minutes past the Naval Battery. Besides squirrels, this is the most common land animal I see here in the warm season. Mature males get beautiful turquoise colors on their undersides and necks. This one is from Point of Rocks and is not quite mature yet. Here are some more. Females usually have contrasting colors and males do not. Notably, their bodies contain anti-Lyme disease properties.
This is the summit. You can tell you are there because there are 3 posts with blazes on them.
It is the 1.1 mile point. There's only 0.47 miles to go until you reach the overlook. Within that 0.47 miles, you will descend for 363 feet. At this point, in the cold season to the west, you can see this mountain on clearer sunsets. I can't tell if it is Mill Mountain that is 55 miles away or Menica Peak, which is 42 miles away. Between here and the overlook approach, I don't really see much as far as scenery or wildlife. The sign that has been here for years has been removed. There are some fallen trees after one of the switchbacks. Almost every time I walk by them in the warm season, I see large fence swifts. There are 2 shortcuts between the summit and the overlook. Most parks do not support the use of shortcut trails. they also cause erosion and destruction of the natural habitat and the intersections with the main trail. There's another treacherous section as you approach the overlook. You might have to climb over some of these rocks. The approach leading to the overlook can be quite spectacular, with the trees framing the view.
Finally, here is the overlook. On weekends, especially if it's not too hot, it can get quite crowded on the overlook. On weekday evenings and mornings, sometimes there are no people there.
This is the 1.48 mile point, the end of the trail. Occasionally, a couple will share a very nice gourmet-style picnic meal here, worthy of smiles and cheerful comments from onlookers. On this day, there was a romantic marriage proposal. Closer to the edge of the overlook, you can get some really nice panoramic views. On crowded days, you may have to wait in line to pose for a picture on the rock. This is the left side of the overlook, the Shenandoah Riverside. Sometimes part of this area is closed off from February to July for peregrine falcon nesting. A winter pastime of visitors to the town and this trail is drinking hot chocolate. On colder days, a thermos just doesn't do the job. This is the point. This is the confluence of the Shenandoah River on the left and the Potomac River on the right. You can see the mixing of them here. This is the right side of the overlook, the Potomac Riverside. This couple climbed straight up the cliff face but hiked back on the trail. Here's the view looking upward from near the edge of the overlook. One day in late August, a trail goer from Florida on the overlook mentioned that there's a tiny lizard near him. When I looked, it was an inch and a half long fence swift. It barely even had a tail. Every time I noticed it, it was around the base of that pine tree you see. In a month's time, I found it about 5 or 6 times. With each encounter, it got bigger and its color changed. I happened to be at the Overlook on the day it left the pine tree for another area. That is it in the last picture that you see. Let's head back now. It is now 1.48 miles to get to the trailhead, plus 0.9 miles if you parked by the train station. I didn't realize it until I actually saw it, but emergency vehicles can make it out here. Here are some at the summit. There's not much else new on the way back. Just be careful not to stumble in the treacherous portion.
You're gonna mess up your uptowns.
Hey man, you chill.
The latest in the season that I've seen toads here was on a November 6th night hike when I saw about 10 of them. After you pass the stone fort sign on the way back, at the next juncture, make a left turn. That will take you to the Naval Battery. This is what it looks like when you make the left turn. If you miss the turn, it's okay. It will route you right back to the main trail, but you will bypass the battery. This section of the trail is flatter and has less rocks and roots. There is not much to see here except for some old faded no hunting signs. Lastly, if it is clear out, leave the Overlook 30 minutes before sunset. That will give you a little light to see with by the time you reach the trailhead. If it's overcast, foggy, or rainy, leave the Overlook 1 hour or more before sunset, especially in the cold season. If not, you will be walking in the dark. Happy trails and have a safe and enjoyable trip.
Come on, you guys.